بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحسن عماه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون الذي بعد فلا يرى وقرب فشهد النجوى تبارك وتعالى والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين وهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا واللائن الدائمة الباقي لأعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم وغاصب حقوقهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم إنما المؤمنون الذين آمنوا بالله ورسوله ثم لم يرتابوا وجاهدوا بأموالهم وأنفسهم في سبيل الله أولئك هم الصادقون صلوات would like to begin by extending tabrikat and best wishes on this celebration that we have in our history in the Shi'i tradition where we have gathered to celebrate the birth anniversary of the Prophet's granddaughter Fatima and Ali's daughter Abbas' beloved sister and the one who became a real partner in the struggle of Hussein ibn Ali. This is Zaynab bint Ali wa Fatima salawatullah alayha. I would like to tonight talk about two important concepts which are very much, you know, common in Quran, in our own conversation also. We hear the words Islam and Iman again and again and again. Quran talks about it. In our own conversation, we talk about it. And I thought maybe it's time to understand these concepts more clearly. However, I didn't want to leave it to the level of abstract and just theory. Sometimes these ideas and concepts become more meaningful when you relate to real examples in history. And that's what I would like to do tonight when we talk about these concepts of Islam and Iman and the difference there. And this is where we will see the greatness of Bibi Zainab, salawatullah alayha, salawat pranik parara. Quran talks about this concept of Islam and Iman many, many times. But even Quran uses stories to clarify these concepts. One of the important ayat in Quran is from Surah Hujarat, Surah number 49 of the Quran. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about an incident towards the end of that surah. This is not a very long surah. It is about 18 ayat. Ayat number 14, 15 and onwards, he talks about the difference between Islam and Iman. We are Muslims, no doubt about it. We are mu'min, especially if you're a Shia of Ali. That's how we define. In our fiqh, actually, whenever the word mu'min is used, it means somebody who believes in the wilayat of Ali. Now, what is the difference between Islam and Iman in that way? The revelation of these ayat towards the end of Surah Hujarat, and the story connected to it makes it very clear. This is in Medina. Already the Prophet is established in Medina. He is the authority in the society. A time came when there was some kind of a drought in one of the areas in the interior of Arabia. There was a tribe by the name of Banu Asad. very different from the tribe who were in Karbala, so don't confuse them. This is in the Arabian Peninsula, closer to Medina than Iraq. And they were suffering from drought. They ran out of the grain, whatever they had. And somebody told them that, you know, why are you worrying about this issue? There is a new Nabi in Medina. He has come with a religion which also has this concept of charity and zakat. You go and accept his religion, you will get your zakat and your problem will be solved. So this was basically a conversion for convenience. Many times we hear stories about marriage, but this is more for something else. And so, you know, they decided to come. A delegation of this tribe came to Medina. They met the Prophet, sat down, and they talked to him using the term that Ya Muhammad Amanna. The word Amanna is a verb form for Iman. That, O Muhammad, we have believed. We have Iman. And the way they talked to the Prophet was, you know, this is where they were very much shrewd in their own diplomacy. They talked to him as if they were making favor to him by becoming Muslims. And when, you know, Rasulullah was, after all, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has presented him as a rahmatun lil alameen. There are different cases in his personal life, in his public life. When people were kind of rude in their, you know, behavior with him, he would still, you know, have sabr and patience, you know, tolerate them. In this case also, Rasulullah didn't really say much. But in this case, and there are some other cases also, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, oh, Muhammad has haya. He is modest. He can tolerate this kind of behavior. But haya is not with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so he intervenes. And this is where this ayat came down. Ayat number 14. قَالَتْ الْعَرَابُ آمَنَّا. Referring to the Prophet, Allah says that these Arab, the Bedouins who have come from the desert, آمَنَّا. They are saying, آمَنَّا, that we have Iman. قُلْ لَمْ تُؤْمِنُوا. O Muhammad, say to them, you don't have Iman. The most that you can see is what? Okay. The most that you can say is what? وَلَكِنْ قُولُوا أَسْلَمْنَا. The only thing that you can say at this stage of your, you know, moving towards Islam is to say, أَسْلَمْنَا. We submit. Or we accept Islam. Don't say amanna. Why? Because when we talk about the issue of Iman, this is where we come to realize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is separating Islam from Iman. This group is being told, say aslamna, don't say amanna. Why? Because when it comes to Islam, this is a matter of tongue, you know, words. You say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah. Everyone, including Rasulullah, is forced to accept you as Muslim. What is in your heart, we don't ask you. We religiously are forced to accept you as Muslims. And in that case, all the duties and all the rights of a Muslim would apply on you. So now that you are going through drought, yes, you will become eligible for zakat. Because you have said, aslamna. But that doesn't mean that you have become mu'min. Because mu'min doesn't come from the tongue. Iman doesn't come from words. It has to come from inside. And that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, do not say, قالت العرب آمنا قل لم تؤمنوا ولكن قولوا أسلمنا. Why? ولما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبكم. Because Iman has not yet entered your hearts. So your kalima of shahadatain is fine. But the Iman has not yet gone down. And therefore you cannot say you are mu'min. And this story and these ayat, when you put them together, you come to realize that, you know, this is very clear, that there is a level of Islam which is beginning, and then you gradually go to the higher level, which would be the level of Iman. Salawat parnek parar. In this same surah, earlier in ayat number 5, where the Prophet is talking about another incident, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about another incident where he says to the Muslims that, you know, if the Prophet was following you and your advice, O Muslims, you will be in more trouble. He is not here to listen to you, you have to listen to him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, remember, I have relieved you from distress by sending the Prophet, believe in him, follow him. And then he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala habbaba ilaykum al-Iman. Allah has made Iman something which you love, which you like. Habbaba from hub, you know, muhabbat. Habbaba ilaykum al-Iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made Iman something that you love and like. وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. And he has made your Iman the zenith for your hearts. Again, this ayat in that same surah is emphasizing that Iman resides in the heart. It is the zenith and, you know, decoration for the heart of a mu'min. Salawat barandek barak. Just to interject here, the criteria of Islam is that people say shahadatain. That's easy. But how can we know there is Iman in the heart or not? There is only one scale that Rasulullah has given to us. There were people in Medina, many of them were munafiq. Ansar of Medina, many prominent members of the Ansar used to say that whenever we had doubt about some of our tribe members, whether they are true believers or hypocrites, we had one standard that Rasulullah had given to us. And what is that standard? Where the Prophet said to Ali, Ya Ali, la yuhibbuka illa mu'min, وَلَا يُبْغُضُكَ إِلَّا مُنَافِقٌ. Nobody will love you or Ali but somebody who is a mu'min. And nobody will hate you but somebody who is a munafiq and a hypocrite. These leaders of Ansar used to say, if we wanted to find out, we would actually talk about Ali in presence of this fellow, and then we'll see what is his attitude. And we'll know whether there is Iman in his heart or not. So there is a difference between the level of Islam and the level of Iman. Salawat Pranek Barar. But this is where I would like to talk to ourselves. Sif zabani kharcha jo hai, ye Islam hai. Just talking about it, this is Islam. But when you talk about Iman, this is not just verbal declaration. Iman means you have to be committed to the faith. You have to dedicate yourself to the faith. And you should have the willingness to sacrifice for Allah, Rasul, and the Imam. Because it is best on the issue of love, which is there in your heart. Love for Allah, love for Rasulullah, and love for the Imams of Ahlul Bayt. And therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next ayat, after talking about this Arab tribe, that lam yadkhul al-Iman fi qulubikum, that Iman has not yet entered your hearts. Then in the next ayat, ayat number 15, he clarifies who are the mu'mineen. And this is where we have to think about it. Because inshallah and alhamdulillah, we are mu'mineen. But this is the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the mu'mineen. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. The first sign of a mu'min is what? That the mu'min believes in Allah and his Rasul, ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. Then he or she does not entertain any doubt. Yartabu is from rayb. Rayb means shak, doubt. This ayat is saying that if there is iman in your heart, there is no room for shak. If you ever have any shak, it means the iman is being diluted or is going away gradually. So the first issue is that we should have this strong belief. Yes, you can question things, you can research about it, you can discuss things, but the faith has to be there, minus any kind of doubts in that way. Not only that, وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. And then they do jihad with their wealth and their lives in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These days the word jihad has become very negative. But remember, we have to learn Islam from ourselves, not from the Western media. Jihad, you know, has two different meanings. And here the word wajahadu is used in the general sense. Those who struggle in all different ways by, you know, sacrificing their wealth, their energy, their time, their talent, their body, their lives for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So jihad is not here talking about, you know, going to fight in the battlefield. It's much broader than that. Even when you get up, now that we are already starting going into the cold season, you get up early in the morning from your warm bed to stand up for Fajr prayers. That itself is a symbol of that jihad. وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ. Your body actually needs to be in the bed, in the warm bed. This is what it's demanding. But you are sacrificing that. So even when you get up for the Fajr prayers, that is jihad. Fasting in the month of Ramadan, especially when Ramadan comes in summer. It is wajib, but this is one form of jihad. بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ. When we have to pay whatever is wajib on us from our wealth, that is also a symbol of jihad. You know, when we talk about all these physical and financial obligations that we have, we have to realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever He has made wajib on us, is actually much lesser than our capacity and our potential. He has been Rahim and Kareem. And just to give an example, let me go to the hadith of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam. Can I ask the brothers on that side of the pillar to move here so I can see your blessed faces, inshallah? Bismillah. The sixth Imam says, والله تعالى ما كلف العباد إلا دون ما يطيقون. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not put obligations on His servants, but that it is less than their ability. يُتِيقُون from taqat. دُونَ مَا يُتِيقُونَ. It's less than their ability. لِأَنَّهُ كَلَّفَهُمْ. Then he gives example. كَلَّفَهُمْ فِي كُلِّ يَوْمٍ وَلَيْلَةٍ خَمْسَ صَلَوَاتٍ. For every day and night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made five namaz wajib on us. Is that the maximum ability that we have? I'm sure you know some people around you who do 52 rakat. If you add nafila prayers and namaz ashab, not only 17. 17 is the wajib and the minimum one. But there are others who do more than that, you know, going all the way to 52 or maybe less somewhere. It means that human beings like us have the potential of doing more than 17 rakat every day and night. But Allah says, what is wajib is only 17. This is one example He's giving. وَكَلَّفَهُمْ فِي السَّنَةِ سِيَامَ ثَلَاثِينَ يَوْمًا. In 1 year, the Imam says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made fasting only for 30 days. But there are many people who actually fast in Rajab and Sha'ban, getting ready for Ramadan. These 3 months are actually connected to one another. Rajab is the month of Ali. Sha'ban is the month of Rasulullah. And Ramadan is the month of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You get ready. From Ali you reach to Rasulullah. From Rasulullah you reach to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's where you will see we are told that the spiritual season in the Islamic calendar is Rajab, Sha'ban and Ramadan. If you look at Mafatihul Jinan, look at the table of contents, you will see that whenever it comes to the a'mal of the month, the rituals, doesn't start from Muharram, Safar, Rabiul Awwal. You will see it starts from Rajab, going all the way back. And the reason why it starts from Rajab, because that is the spiritual season according to the Islamic calendar. And so Imam is saying Allah has made Ramadan wajib on us. But there are others who fast for Rajab and Sha'ban also. It means humanly we have this capacity to fast more than 30 days. Then he says, وَكَلَّفَهُمْ فِي كُلِّ مِعَةٍ دِرْهَمْ خَمْسَةَ دَرَاهِمْ. You know, he's talking about the ratio of talking about the charities, zakat, and others. He says, from 100 dirham, you only pay 5. But there is an ability among people to give more. You know, even when we talk about our own centers and our programs, you know, we talk about khums, but remember there is something 80% is still there. That's yours. You are giving from Imam's portion. What about that 80% which belongs to you? And so this is where we come to realize that even when it comes to financial obligations, you know, people have the ability to give more than what is wajib on them. And then he says, وَكَلَّفَهُمْ حَجَّةً وَاحِدَةً. When it comes to hajj, Allah made it only wajib once in a lifetime. And mashallah, we have people, you know, who have gone 30 times, you know, or more. It means, you know, people have the ability to do multiple hajj, but it's wajib only once. وَهُمْ يَتِيقُونَ أَكْثَرُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. People have the ability to do more than that. So when we talk about وَجَاهَدُوا أَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, we do realize that, you know, there is a commitment. There has to be a sense of sacrifice, of doing more than what is the wajib and the minimum that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has imposed on us. Salawat upon the Quran. And once you reach to that level of Iman, what is your status? What is the reward that Allah has given for you? In Surah Tawbah, Surah number 9, Ayat 20, 21, 22. And remember, Surah Tawbah is one of the last surahs to be revealed. And so these are kind of, you know, final verdicts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Those who have Iman, who believe, and who migrate for the sake of their faith, to protect it, and do jihad fi sabilillah, in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bi amwalihim wa anfusihim, with their wealth and their lives, أَعْظَمُ دَرَجَةً عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. They are at a higher level in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَائِزُونَ. They are the one who have achieved higher levels. And what is that achievement? يُبَشِّرُهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ. Allah gives them good news, good tidings. بِرَحْمَةٍ مِنُهُ. Number one, mercy from him. وَرِضْوَانٍ. And the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah is razi with you, what else do you want? وَجَنَّاتٍ. And then he comes to the, you know, physical reward. وَجَنَّاتٍ لَهُمْ فِيهَا نَعِيمٌ مُقِيمٌ. And the gardens in Jannah that he's going to give you, where you're going to be there permanently. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا عَبَدًا. Forever. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ أَجْرٌ عَظِيمٌ. He has a great reward for the mu'mineen in this sense. And so Islam is just a community issue. It is a matter of this dunya. You know, we recognize one another. We have the rights and obligations towards one another. But what is going to be helpful to us and guarantee our salvation in the hereafter is not verbal declaration, it is Iman. Which is a serious commitment that we need to make with Allah, Rasul, and the Imam of the time. Salawat Manan Ekbar. These are all concepts that I talked about. Let us look at three examples. Since it is the Wiladat of Bibi Zainab, I would like to talk about three examples from the great women in our history. Not necessarily in the era of Islam all the time, but those who are respected highly in Islam. The first example is of before Islam. Remember always this term, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. That's the faith part of it. Mu'min is somebody who believes and does not entertain any doubt. وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَنْفُسِهِمْ. Then on a practical level, they struggle with their wealth and their persons, their lives, and their body for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That second part, this is where we are looking for examples. Āsiya bint Muzāhim, the wife of Fir'aun. It's amazing, you know, that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Tahrim, you know, Surah number 66, singles her out as an example for the believers. And why is it that? ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah says, I give you an example for those who are believers. إِمْرَأَةَ فِرْعَوْن, the wife of Fir'aun, Āsiya. Just think about her. She is the queen of Egypt. She has everything that you could think of as far as worldly, you know, point of his concern. Even now, people go and admire pyramids and everything that they see from the relics and legacy of that time. You know, she had everything. You're talking about wealth and comfort. You're talking about status and prestige. You're talking about power and influence. Everything that the modern man and woman desires in this world, she had that. Nothing was missing. But then, in spite of having everything, when Musa alayhi salam grows up, you know, that incident of he leaves Egypt, goes for 10 years to Madian, then he comes back, with the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the signs of miracles, and presents his message to Fir'aun and the people of Fir'aun, when she saw the truth. In the message of Musa, who was like an adopted son for her, she decided to leave everything that she had and accept that message. You know, we talk about peer pressure. Family pressure, these are all real things, huh? People go through. Parents say, Maulana, kya kare? हम तो ये नाच गाना नहीं चाह रहे थे शादी में लेकिन बच्चों ने मजबूर कर दिया. This was what people like me hear when we say, "Well, sorry, I cannot come to that gathering for nikah." So then you are closed in a small room, the bridal room. Maulana is going now there to recite nikah there in the corner, and then they will go to the function. MashaAllah. And when you say, "What is it?" Either you are a very committed person, he says, majboori hai. Family pressure. Whether from children, parents, friends, business, society. And this is where we have to realize, think about Āsiya. What kind of a pressure that she went through. Her husband is the king. There are people around in the family who are with Fir'aun. They must have been, you know, pressured to a level that we cannot even imagine. Yet Āsiya does not give in. Fir'aun tried everything to the extent that he actually now goes to the level of torturing her. That you will have to abandon your Imān to this God of Musa and Harun. She's yet, even after that, she refuses. And at the end, this Fir'aun, who was a tyrant, decided to actually crucify her. Put on the cross. Think about it. Her background as the queen, and she's put to this test and trial of that level, yet she refuses to abandon her faith. And when she is there on the cross, she prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that dua of Āsiya, Allah has preserved that in Surah Tahrim, ayat number 11. As long as the dunya is there, Quran would be there. And this dua of Āsiya on the cross is there. What is the dua? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah gives you an example to the believers. Example of whom? إِمْرَأَةَ فِرْعَوْن. The woman, the wife of Fir'aun, is قَالَت. When she said. Now the Quran doesn't give us the context, but we know the history and the ahadith about it. That this happened when she is put already on the cross. What did she say? She prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rabbi ibni li indaka baytan fil jannah. Oh Allah, make a house for me in the Jannah. She has the biggest of palace that you can think about. Greater than what we see now. She says, I don't want this. Wallah, you know, give me a palace in the Jannah. وَنَجِّنِ مِنْ فِرْعَوْنِ وَعَمَلِهِ. And Allah, rescue me from Fir'aun and his deeds and misdeeds. وَنَجِّنِ مِنْ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. And, you know, deliver me from the unjust people. According to the hadith that we have under this ayat, and the narrations we have historically, we are told that an angel then came to her while she is there on the cross after her dua. The angel comes and he says, Āsiya, Allah has accepted your dua. This is the palace that he has reserved for you in Jannah. And when she saw that, there was a smile on her just before she took her last breath. And this is the example of what we call Imān and jihad. Where you should have this commitment that if time, you know, situation demands, you will still be firm on your Imān. Salawat padhne ek baar. This is the early time, before Islam. Look at the situation of Islam itself. You know, Islam is not a religion of men. MashaAllah, you all have sacrificed your manhole upstairs and you come down here. You know, at least you respect ladies sometimes. They will have a better space than us. And this is you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran is giving us this example of Āsiya. Another example that you have in our own history of Islam is the second lady who had been, you know, declared by Rasulullah to be among the four best of the women in the world, and that is Khadijah bint Khuwaylid salawatullah alayha. See, when we talk about sacrifice and jihad, those who don't have much, you know, it's easy for them to sacrifice. But those who have much, it's more challenging and more difficult. Example of Āsiya, example of Khadijah. She was one of the richest person in Mecca at that time. There were two trade caravans who would go from Mecca. One, you know, during the summertime to Damascus, which was a market for, you know, traders coming from Eastern Europe and Africa. And the other caravan in winter would go to South Yemen. And that's where the traders coming from Asia, India, and China would come. So these people of Mecca were basically the middlemen, buying from east, selling to west and south, or the other way around. And so two trade caravans used to go. This is in Surah Quraysh. Allah talks about it. And historians actually tell us that when you look at the number of camels which are taking the goods from Mecca, you know, about half of them would be the camels belonging to Khadijah. That was the, you know, richness that she had as far as her wealth is concerned. But when it comes to the issue of, you know, even selecting a spouse, she was not looking for money or any tribal, you know, prestige or status. She was looking for strong and solid character, which she found in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when Islam started, the final message of Allah came in the cave of Hira, the first revelation of ayat of Quran, and the Prophet comes home from that cave. She immediately accepts the message of Rasulullah. And that is why you hear in history, even all others also in among Muslim historians, say that yes, she was the first person to accept Islam. Not only that, she was there with Rasulullah in his initial struggles. Actually, she is now placing her wealth at the disposal of Rasulullah for the service of Islam. She is saying that you can use this. Even the migration of about 70 to 80 individuals from Mecca to Abyssinia was in a way financed by the wealth of Khadijah. And it's not only that, you know, when she had things and she was comfortable, she was with Rasulullah. No. When the Quraysh decided to oppose the Prophet, and they tried to, they couldn't harm the Prophet as long as Abu Talib was alive. Initially they went and, you know, gave him an ultimatum, either you separate yourself from your nephew and let us deal with him directly, or we will put you and your entire Banu Hashim clan in under socio-economic boycott. Abu Talib refused. He said, doesn't matter, whatever you want to do. Nobody would talk to them. Any kind of marriage proposal were, you know, even forbidden at that time. Nobody would buy or sell anything to them, nothing. And it became such a situation that Abu Talib realized that even their lives were in danger. And he moved the entire Banu Hashim clan from the city to a property he had outside, known as Sha'b Abi Talib. 3 years they spent there. Many times they would go without food. Khadijah not even once complained about it. Just look at her affluence, her wealth, her comfort, the background that she comes from. But when Islam is asking for sacrifice, she is willingly being part of this struggle with Rasulullah. And that is that we have to keep in mind. And Rasulullah never ever forgot the sacrifice of Khadijah. As long as she was alive, he did not marry anyone else. You know, hamare ek bahut hi mashhoor khateeb guzre hain, Mirza Athar sahab marhoom, Khuda unke darajat ko buland farmaye. Unka ek jumla tha, yahi Majlis Tondo mein padha tha unhone, ki bhai Rasool ne sirf ek shaadi ki thi, dusri bibiyon ne Rasool se shaadi ki thi. And you can see the impact that her, you know, personality, her character, her sacrifice had on the Prophet, that the Prophet never forgot her. Whenever there was a qurbani, he would always dedicate one part, the good one, for the relatives of Khadijah. Bukhari actually has a narration, very interesting. She said one day, and this is a narration from Aisha, that one day the Prophet remembered Khadijah and praised her. And this is her narration, فَغِرْتُ. You know, I became jealous. And Bukhari is quoting this. And فَقُلْتُ. And I said to Rasulullah, مَا تَذْكُرُ مِنْ عُجُوزِ مِنْ عَجَائِزِ قُرَيْشِ. How long you will remember this old lady from Quraysh? You know, who's now losing her teeth, become old. وَقَدْ أَبْدَلَكَ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا مِنْهَا. Whereas Allah has now replaced better for you. Bukhari has a typical attitude towards Amir al-Mu'min Ahl al-Bayt. He gives this quotation, and he quotes these words of Aisha, but then he doesn't say what was the response of Rasulullah. He stops the story there. But the other muhaddiseen and historians, including Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, Imam Tirmizi, and the historian Ibn Kathir, who actually gave the whole narration, that when she uttered these words about Khadijah, فَتَغَيَّرَ وَجْهُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. And these are again her words continuing. Bukhari tried to conceal it. Other sources are now continuing, فَتَغَيَّرَ وَجْهُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمْ تَغَيَّرًا لَمْ عَرُهُ تَغَيُّرُ عِنْدَ شَيْءٍ قَدْتُ إِلَّا عِنْدَ نُزُولِ الْوَحِي. Rasulullah's face turned, you know, in such a way that I would only see that change when wahi and revelation was coming on him. And then he turned to her and says, كَيْفَ قُلْتِ. How can you say this about Khadija? وَاللَّهِ لَقَدْ آمَنَتْ بِي إِذْ كَذَّبَنِ النَّاسِ. By Allah, Khadija believed in my message when people were rejecting me. وَعَاوَتْنِي إِذْ رَفَضَنِ النَّاسِ. She is the one, she supported me, sheltered me when people were pushing me away. And the most importantly, the Prophet says, وَرُزِقْتُ مِنَهَا الْوَلَدِ. And Allah blessed me with children through her. وَحَرَّمْتُمُوهُ مِنِّي. And he has deprived you from my children. وَرَاحَ عَلَيَّ بِهَا شَهْرًا. She says that then the Prophet became so angry with that statement I made that he didn't come to me for 1 month. And this is where you realize that, you know, although Khadija died before the Hijrah, but she was still considered to be the most important figure as far as her struggle and support and loyalty to Islam is concerned. You know, the Prophet actually used to say, مَا قَامَ وَلَا اسْتَقَامَ دِينِي illa bi sayfi aliyin wa mali khadijah. That my, deen did not stand up and maintain its stability, but by the sword of Ali and the wealth of Khadijah. Salawat. And so this is where we see the issue of, when we talk about mu'mineen, the example of what does it mean to be mu'min or a mu'mina. These are the example of the women. And let me now, conclude with the example of the lady whose birth anniversary we are celebrating tonight, and that is Zainab, salawatullah alayha. Salawat. Of course, she comes from a family where she would get all these, qualities in her genes, whether it is from the sacrifice of Khadijah or the struggle of Rasulullah or Ali and Fatima. She also, I think something we don't know much about her because we only know more her about her in the context of Karbala and what happened there and after that. But there is one thing we have to realize, that her life also, like Āsiya and Khadijah, at a different level, after she got married to Abdullah bin Ja'far, was a comfortable life. Abdullah bin Ja'far was young when his father Ja'far became Shaheed. And so he started, getting into this trade and business. And the very first deal that he did was actually, he was able to get a sheep and then sell that. And when the Prophet was alive at that time, when the Prophet saw, he prayed for him. Allahumma barik lahu fi tijaratihi. Oh Allah, bless his trade in business. And if Rasulullah does, dua for barakat, there will be barakat and barakat. And Abdullah bin Ja'far himself says, فَمَا بِعْتُ شَيْئًا وَلَا اشْتَرَيْتُ إِلَّا بُورِكَ لِيهِ فِيهِ. He says, never did I sell or buy something that Allah blessed me in it. Eventually, he accumulated quite a lot of wealth, became a very successful businessman, and he also had properties even in Sham. This whole issue of why he went to Sham multiple times, and even Janab Zainab's Rosa is there, because he owned properties over there. And this means that his life was not a life of struggle and poverty as far as wealth is concerned. So Bibi Zainab now is married to a person who is affluent, who is wealthy. But remember, even Abdullah bin Ja'far was not somebody who was tied to his wealth. While Allah had blessed him and given him barakat on one hand, he was also known very much in the Arab society at that time as a very generous and charitable person. In this generosity, he actually inherited from his father, who was also known as a very generous and kind person. Sunni historians actually sometimes use the word for him, a description for Abdullah bin Ja'far. They say he was Qutb al-Sakha. Qutb al-Sakha, which means he was pillar of generosity. Another Sunni historian, Ibn Abdul Bar, actually says that Abdullah was kariman, a noble person, jawadan dharifan, he was generous person, khaliqan afifan sakhiyan, a very good-mannered person, very charitable. Yusamma, he was known as Bahrul Jood. Means he was the ocean of generosity. يُقَالُ أَنَّهُ لَمْ يَكُنْ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ أَسْخَأَ مِنْهُ. It is said that there was nobody more generous than him in the world of Islam at that time. And this is where, we see that Zainab was living with Abdullah bin Ja'far, and we can assume that her life, as far as, the worldly comfort is concerned, would have been a good life. But this is where we see, just as we saw in the example of Āsiya, in the example of Bibi Khadijah, that when we see the example of Zainab, that although she comes, she's wife of somebody who is, you know, affluent and generous, when Islam demands that Zainab, now I need you. When Hussein starts his struggle, she has no difficulty at all in leaving everything and going through this jihad, sacrificing her time, her energy, physically, you know, giving for the service of Islam. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, it's not only the issue of Zainab herself, Abdullah bin Ja'far also. On and Muhammad were not with Zainab when she left Medina with Imam Hussein alayhi salam to go to Mecca. It was only when Imam decided to leave Mecca to go towards Karbala, this is where Abdullah bin Ja'far brings his sons all the way to Mecca, and at the end, he says, these two sons will be there on my behalf. And he used to take pride later on, that I'm proud that my sons were there in my place to sacrifice their lives for Islam. And so this issue, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا, that's the Aqidah part, وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. This is an important commitment from us as far as Iman is concerned. And Zainab for us, like Asiya and Khadijah, are best of examples of how to live the life of a mu'min. You can have everything as far as the ni'mat and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is concerned, but that willingness to be committed to Islam and to sacrifice for the sake of Islam should be there at all the time. You know, we call Zainab in many writings, you will see in many speech, we say she was Sharikatul Hussein. This is not only poetry. Sharikatul Hussein means somebody who was partner of Hussein in the struggle. Because Karbala can be divided into two parts, till Ashura and after Ashura. Till the day of Ashura, the leader of that movement was Hussein bin Ali. After Ashura, the person who led that movement and continued that was Zainab bint Ali. And that is why she is known as Sharikatul Hussein. She is partner with Hussein in the struggle for the survival of Islam. Salawat Pranayak Parawar. جناب زینب کے عظمت کے سلسلے میں کچھ باتیں ہم نے آپ کے سامنے پیش کی ہیں تاکہ ہمیں اندازہ ہو کہ اسلام صرف مردوں کا دین نہیں ہے, خواتین کا بھی اتنا ہی اہم رول ہے جس طرح سے مردوں کا ہے. ہمارے سامنے مثالیں ہیں, جہاں جناب آسیہ کی مثال ہم نے دی ہے آپ کے سامنے, جناب خدیجہ کی مثال دی ہے, جناب زینب کی مثال دی ہے, اور یہ وہ مثالیں ہیں جس سے اندازہ ہوتا ہے کہ ہمارے دین اور بقا صرف مردوں کے جہاد سے نہیں ہے بلکہ خواتین اور مومنات کی قربانیوں سے بھی ہے. بلکہ اکثر ہم کربلا کے حوالے سے ایک جملہ کہتے ہیں کہ یہ کربلا میں جتنے نوجوان اور جوان شہید ہوتے ہیں یہ صرف وہ شہید نہیں ہوئے ہیں, یہ ماں کی تربیت کا اثر ہے. ہم لوگ ان کی تعریف کرتے ہیں, یہ بھول جاتے ہیں کہ ایک ماں پیچھے ہے جس نے اپنے اولاد کو اس طرح سے تربیت دی ہے کہ جب وقت آتا ہے قربانی کے لیے تو وہ تیار ہو جاتے ہیں. کوئی ان کو پہلے سے نہیں تیار کیا گیا تھا. ایک اور جملہ, چونکہ ہمارا ٹائم ختم ہو رہا ہے, لیکن پیپل آس می مولانا امام زمانہ کی تیاری کے لیے ہم کیا کریں؟ کیا آپ سمجھتے ہیں کہ یہ جو جوان جو کربلا میں تھے ان کو ایک مہینہ پہلے سے تیار کیا جا رہا تھا کہ تمہیں کیا کرنا ہے؟ سیمینارز ہوتے تھے, اسپریچول ریٹریٹس ہوتے تھے کہ ہاؤ ٹو گیٹ ریڈی فار کربلا؟ نو, امام زمان علیہ السلام کے لیے تیاری کا مطلب یہ نہیں ہے کہ اسپیشل کیمپ میں جانا ہے, sessions mein jana hai, seminars mein jana hai, majlison mein jana hai, ye sab hai. Just be a mu'min or a mu'mina by yourself. If you are a mu'min and a mu'mina and you fulfill the demands of Iman, you are ready when the time comes. جناب قاسم یا اون محمد یا علی اکبر انہوں کوئی پہلے سے نہیں تیار کیا گیا تھا تین مہینہ پہلے کہ بھئی ایک دن آئے گا کہ جہاں جان دینی ہے نہیں وہ علم ہونا چاہیے معرفت ہونی چاہیے وہ جذبہ ہونا چاہیے اور وہ ایمان کا تقاضا ہے جناب زینب ہمارے لحاظ سے اس لیے اہم ہیں کہ جب وقت آیا she was ready to go یہ نہیں کہ بیٹھ کے جو ہے سیمینارز ہوئے ڈسکشنز ہوئے نہیں تو اس بات کو ذہن میں رکھیں کہ ایمان ہمارے آخرت کے نجات کی ضمانت اسی میں ہے اور اس کے لیے ہمیں ہمیشہ تیار رہنا پڑے گا بس آخر میں محسن نقوی شہید کے کچھ کلام کو پڑھ کے ہم ختم کرنا چاہیں گے جو جناب سید جناب زینب کے عظمت میں بیان کرتے ہیں کہ عجب مسیحا مزاج خاتون تھی زینب نے تلوار تو نہیں چلائی تھی عجب مسیحا مزاج خاتون تھی کہ لفظوں کے کیمیا سے حسینیت کو بھی سانس لینا سکھا گئی ہے علی کی بیٹی She had messianic in aura that by magical words Ali's daughter taught survival to حسینیت بھٹک رہا تھا دماغ انسانیت جہالت کی تیرگی میں Human mind was wandering in darkness of ignorance جہنم کے اندھے بشر کو رستہ دکھا گئی ہے علی کی بیٹی Those who were blind in this dunya She showed the way to them نہ کوئی لشکر نہ سر پہ چادر مگر نہ جانے ہوا میں کیوں کر غرور ظلم و ستم کے پرزے اڑا گئی ہے علی کی بیٹی Without any army, without her chadar, I don't know how, Ali's daughter scattered the dust of tyranny. یقین آئے تو کوفہ و شام کی فضاؤں سے پوچھ لینا یزیدیت کی نقوش سارے مٹا گئی ہے علی کی بیٹی آپ نے یہ نہیں دیکھا ہوگا کہ کہیں بھی کسی مسلمانوں میں کوئی قافلے تیار ہوتے ہوں کہ چلو شام چلیں معاویہ کی زیارت کے لیے یا یزید کی زیارت کے لیے وہ جائیں گے بھی تو کچھ ملے گا بھی نہیں ان کو اس لیے کہ وہ علاقہ ہے جو زینب کا علاقہ ہو گیا ہے یہی شام تھا لبنان اور سیریا جسے آپ کہتے ہیں جہاں علی کو لوگ کافر کہتے تھے نعوذ باللہ لیکن وہیں آپ دیکھیں کہ فی الحال جو طاقت ہے جو عظمت ہے وہ علی کے شیعوں کی ہے اور یہ اس لیے ہے کہ زینب نے خداوند عالم کے ذکر کو ہمیشہ بلند و بالا رکھا لہٰذا خداوند عالم کبھی بھی زینب کے ذکر کو نیچے اترنے نہیں دے گا لوگ ہمیشہ یاد کریں گے اور ایک جملے پہ ہم ختم کرنا چاہیں گے کہ یہ وہ بی بی ہیں جن کے دو مزار ہیں ایک کائرو میں ہے اور ایک دمسکس میں ہے شیعہ یہاں زیادہ تر جاتے ہیں سنی وہاں جاتے ہیں لیکن تعجب کی بات یہ ہے کہ مرادیں یہاں بھی قبول ہوتی ہیں وہاں بھی قبول ہوتی ہیں اس سے بڑھ کے اور کیا عظمت ہو سکتی ہے اس بی بی کی بس انہی کے نام کو یاد کرتے ہوئے خداوند عالم کی بارگاہ سے دعا ہے خداوندہ اس قلیل بات قبول فرما ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے ہمارے توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما خداوندہ عالم اسلام میں صلح اور امن کی فضا پیدا کر شیعان علی کو اپنے حفظ امان میں رکھ امام کے ظہور میں تعجل فرما ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم